Welcome, if the mic works. Welcome. Can you hear me? Good? No. Lovely. I do have actually a very loud voice, so I can project if need be, but is mic on? Not on, okay. Or as Ronnie used to say, is mic on? I can't swear on the mic these days, it's not allowed. So you may or may not know, this is part of a live stream that we're broadcasting on YouTube and Facebook. And this is, we're live now, and we did publicize it in all sorts of places. So hopefully all of you know about this. But before we bring this fantastic band on tonight, well, the band is here, of course, but we're going to bring on our first drummer. Just like to say a few jazz club house rules. The first one is to keep the conversation to a minimum. Turn your phones off. And filming and photography is not allowed. Now, Ronnie Scott's was the highlight of any European tour for the Buddy Rich band from the late 60s to the late 80s. And this was a place where the band used to reside for quite a few nights. And not only did Buddy bring his fantastic band to the club, but his charisma and prowess on the drums. He was also a very witty man and would match Ronnie Scott, the club owner, line for line. I mean, that was something to behold. But we have this fantastic opportunity to reconnect with the Buddy Rich legacy, courtesy of Cathy Rich, for which we're very grateful. And as you can see, we have this great band here, the creme de la creme, British, and some Buddy Rich alumni in the band. And please, would you show your appreciation for the Buddy Rich big band and our first drummer, the fabulous Gregg Potter.
Took them. came out a little faster than I thought. That's why I gave you a little extra drums in the middle to catch up. You know what I mean? Just read the measures and just follow me. A lot of drums in here. Right there, you'll see it. Yeah. I thought that stuff was wallpaper at our house. Okay. You don't mess around with these guys. How about this band? One song, I'm done. The clothes cost more than the whole band. The belt buckle weighs more than me. Wow, I gotta take a break. Don't play this stuff so fast.
We'll be right back.
wait a second, is it break time yet? No, not yet. Well, first of all, thank you all so much for coming here to the legendary Ronnie Scott's to come out and see the Buddy Rich Band there. This is just a dream come true. I mean, I know it all sounds, but this is such a big deal. I mean, Buddy played here. His pictures are on that wall. His pictures are even in the dressing room. So he even washes me when I change. Man, if he saw me put Kathy's clothes on, we'd really be in trouble. I don't. I'm saying it's dark back there, but there's like pictures of Buddy back there. Everywhere you walk, he's looking at you. What are you doing? Nothing. All right, but thank you so much for coming out. And let me keep playing here. And I'm sure I'll pick up the microphone again because I just use this to take a little break. You know what I mean? I talk and then I could rest. These drums get bigger. Each set, the drum set gets bigger. They raise the seat, tighten my pants. All right, let me get back to this here. I'm gonna give you a little hat up front, and then you guys come in, all right? All right.
You don't mess around with these guys. They really played with Buddy. Right. They can yell at you. You're in a good mood, right? Yeah, actually, let him play more. We'll be right back.
That was the real ending. You went too short the last time. We made it longer that time. That was the real ending. Oh, I know. Well, you just have to play a little less a little bit later. You know what I mean? That's how it works out. So, God, I guess I've been drinking. Well, again, thank you so much for coming out here to the legendary Ronnie Scott's, and the evening of music that we have planned for you is just incredible. I mean, remember why we're all here. Buddy Rich. I mean, I know we can go on and on, and I can go on and on about just what Buddy Rich, what it means. I mean, but just the music that he brought, of course, the drumming ability, the drumming styles, just everything about the man, the music. It's too big to contain into this one conversation I'm going to have with you here today. And I'm actually going to introduce the real reason why we're here today, along with Buddy Rich. The person that has put all of this together. I know there have been many people that Ronnie Scott's and Simon and the people that are involved at Ronnie Scott's, and of course Toby Cruz, who brought us here 5 years ago to play at the London Palladium for the 25th Memorial Buddy Rich concert. Big, wonderful event. One night. Here we got to stay a whole week. That's awesome. Incredible. Thank you guys so much. But let me introduce to you the person that really, you know, makes this stuff happen, along with the wonderful people I've mentioned, but a person that's very important to this whole Buddy Rich extravaganza. And that would be the lovely, beautiful, talented, who I believe at some point, at like 12 years old, she was at this club. She was at this club with Buddy many times, and I believe she was drunk at like 12 and a half. But it's good, because we've kept her sober for like 10 years. So how old would that make her? 22? Okay. 21. So we've kept her sober, and we brought her back to Ronnie Scott's, or she brought us back here. So if you see her, just don't buy her a drink. But let me introduce to you the beautiful and talented, and she'll continue to explain exactly the whole Buddy Rich thing. And that would be the beautiful and lovely Cathy Rich.
Thank you.
You don't usually get an introduction with being drunk at 12.
I really don't. That's interesting.
You could do that in this country.
Okay. But
you could drink anytime you want.
It wasn't Ronnie Scott's where I was 12 and drunk. It was in Los Angeles. Oh, but that sounds weird, doesn't it?
Hollywood
I really
people.
Wasn't 12 and drunk. I was just 12 and singing. But thank you. Again, you know, Gregg pretty much said it all. We are thrilled to be here, obviously. The last time I was here was with my father in 1986, and he was recording here. And it's been a very emotional week, actually, because, you know, you walk through these doors, and there's so much history of our family here, and there's pictures of him everywhere, and it gets to me. But we thank you. We're here celebrating his 100th birthday year, which is pretty amazing when you think about it, because I can't imagine what he'd be like at 100. Pretty crazy. He'd be doing that still. He'd still be playing, I'm sure. But going back to when I was 12 and drunk, if I may digress, there was an album that he recorded in L.A. at that time called Big Swing Face. And he asked me if I would come and sing this song that we had heard on the radio called The Beat Goes On. And I said, sure, let's do it. So we went there, and we pulled up to a nightclub, and I said, I thought we were recording. And he said, we are. And I said, live in front of people? And he said, yes. And I said, I can't do it. I can't do it. I've never sung in front of anyone before, so I can't do it. Blah, blah, blah. He talked me into it. And the cut that we did one time is the one that's on the album. So we're going to do The Beat Goes On. There we go.
Drums keep pounding a rhythm to the brain. La-di-da-di-dee. La-di-da-di-da. Charles
So much. I appreciate that. Thank you. So we fast forward a few years, and I'm now 17, and my dad is here in Ronnie's recording an album that ended up being called Rich in London. And my friends and I were singing a song for him in the dressing room, and he said, let's record that tomorrow night. He had that for some reason. He always wanted me to do it like the next day or the next week. Didn't give me a chance to figure it out. So he had somebody write a chart that night. The next night we recorded it live here. And again, no rehearsing. And the cut that you hear is the only time we did it. It's the one on the record. It's called That's Enough. That's a story. Talking about me, really I don't mind. They try to stop me and block my progress most of the time. Well, the mean things to say never make me feel bad. Again, I miss a friend that I never had. Well, I got the Lord, that's enough. Well, there were so many times that I didn't have a dime, couldn't call on nobody but the Lord. Well, he heard my plea, came down to see about me. He's my Lord. Ronnie. Thank you. Thank you so much. Wow. That's awesome. Thank you. Appreciate that. So, you gonna do one more here before we bring out?
I've got dinner plans.
Oh, you do? Well, we better hurry up then. I'll be back to introduce all of these fine men to you and maybe sing again. Thank you. Thanks for being here.
Dry clean. And it looks like I'm gonna have to, how about this band? Both sides. We gotta refresh their drinks here. They need 2 limes and a lemon and 3 olives. Set them up if you could get that done. Thank you so much for coming out. I'll stand here a second. Thank you so much for coming out.
Okay, the great person, the British street band and gentlemen. The stage, and we'll be back with the second set with the fantastic Dave Weckl on drums. Thank you.
Hello everybody, we're here in the backstage dressing room of Ronnie Scott's club with the delightful couple that you see to my right. And first of all we have Cathy Rich, son of the great Buddy, and of course we have Gregg Potter as well, official drummer with the Buddy Rich big band, and they're playing here at the club this week, and you'll be seeing the streaming, or you will have seen some of the streaming and some to come tonight. And we're going to just ask a few questions and to set some of the scene for the music. So over to Cathy.
Yes.
Can you remember when you first became aware of your father and his music?
Wow, that's a good one. It's, you know, early on, because, you know, that we always played music in the house, and I was always, from the time I was 2 years old, I was traveling across the world with him. So it wasn't probably until I was maybe 8 or 9 years old that I realized that life was a little different than most of the people I was going to school with. So right around 8 years old, I probably realized that, he does something different for a living.
So were you traveling pre the 66 band,
yes.
You know, when he formed his own band, he played with Harry James before that, allegedly the highest paid drummer in the world. And prior to that with various big bands, but also with jazz at the Philharmonic.
Yes.
So did you get to meet some of these legendary musicians,
always.
Lester Young and...
that's a little before.
Okay,
me, but
sure.
Ella, obviously, you know, and all the jazz at the Philharmonic, he was traveling with when I was about, I think, 2 years old. So they were traveling all over the world. So I remember my first trip to Hong Kong and the Far East was probably at 2.
Mm.
And he was doing that then. So very exciting. And then he went to Japan with Harry and I was with that.
Yeah.
So anytime I wasn't in school or doing something, I was on the road.
I think I read that your father never practiced.
No.
Well, certainly at home. The playing was the main thing.
There it is.
Yeah.
The playing was the practice, actually.
And so. can you, from your very close perspective, explain the phenomenon of Buddy Rich? Do you think starting so young as a vaudeville entertainer mm-hmm. made him almost superhuman as a performer?
Yeah, I think when you start, well, again, his gift was, you know, from above, so that you can't really explain it. Because it started so young, and he was 18 months old when they realized that he had this ability. So I think that because he started and never stopped, you know, until he was almost 70 years old, that's a long career. So practicing, never. But he played 300 days out of the year. So how can you not be better? You know, you're playing all the time. So he was already amazing, and I think he got better as he got older.
So over to Gregg, and could you tell me about your introduction to Buddy's music, how you got involved as a drummer with a band, and so on?
I think that happened on Match.com, too.
Fair enough.
That was one of my likes, and she said, okay, I like that.
Okay.
Now, my introduction to Buddy, it's not funny, but when you talk to any drummer, it's the Roar of 74 was my first album. So I'm thinking, oh, this is all this man did, or just you didn't realize that, like you said, that 1966 prior to 66. But I'm saying the Buddy Band, there were many other records and other recordings. But yes, my introduction would have been the album 1974 or the album Roar 74. So around 1974, 75 would be when all of a sudden there's this drumming, because I don't, I really don't.
I mean, that's a pretty funky, rocky album, isn't it? I mean, with
It opens up with Nutville, Kilimanjaro Cookout, but you've got Nutville and Time Check. Those are the bard, but Kilimanjaro Cookout. And, but I'm saying, and also you had television at that time. So you were able to, now you have the internet and the YouTube. So, I mean, now you could see everybody do everything. But I'm saying back then to see Buddy on the telly, as they call it here in London.
Very nice.
And we have Johnny Carson, and they have
Michael Parsons.
So I'm saying, seeing him on those talk shows, and then you saw how the man acted, plus he sat and played the drums. So it would be from that point on, just that became the
the bar of where you wanted to play a set of drums, be if I were playing with a rock group or whatever I was doing. You sat behind a set of drums, buddy was just over your head,
yeah, just over there.
And just, it was where you wanted. His kit was cool. I mean, it wasn't like he was kind of set up. You know, sometimes you do see things from the past or what's going on, because he was considered a jazz drummer, but he certainly didn't play that way. He banged on his bass drum. He should have been John Bonham. He should have been in Led Zeppelin. I mean, the guy did play. He stretched his styles. And so I'm saying it wasn't like, oh, you're listening to that. He just, to me, was the all-around, I liked him on any level,
it
jazz, rock, whatever I was doing. I always had that buddy. Now, to have this dream opportunity, not only the romance that I found on match.com, no, but the relationship wasn't based on, her and I did not sit about and go, God, now Buddy's left hand, was he, did he actually, the relationship wasn't based on that.
Never talking about drums.
Right, but it was through the memorial concerts that she has put on from 1989 on. There have been certain aspects of the show that have always stood out, and that was that anytime she would bring a pop drummer or a rock drummer around this group, it always seemed to pique the interest of audiences. Neil Peart from Rush was her most, that was the most, like...
Yeah, people were amazed.
They just were amazed.
Neil would even do something like
that. And that when he did, the interest peaked, and it also brought another, a younger, not, I shouldn't say younger, but different. It brought a different audience to Buddy Rich and the big band, which is what we are also trying to do here, too. We want this music to get out and Buddy to stay on the top, of course. But with bringing this other element into it, because big band drummers, unfortunately, Dave Tuff is no longer with us. And Max Roach?
No longer with us.
Cozy Cole?
Not here.
So I'm saying...
Louis Belson?
God bless him. Ed Shaughnessy. I'm saying, so we're losing, you know, we really can't, Kathy can't pull from a pool of, well, let's get whatever. Ooh. So we wanted to continue on in a getting these audiences. So when we did, what was the relationship based on prior to talking about the music? When we stopped talking about that, and we did talk about the band, we had an idea to, why don't we try recording the band with a drummer like myself who has studied and yes, I come from maybe not the strict jazz world, but enough that let's do this, incorporate some of the different aspects. It seems to have worked at this point in that.
Yeah.
I just wanted to bring the album forward here. This is one that was recorded at this club in 1971. And... not only is the band there, but dear Cathy is singing a tune on it with two Hendrix daughters of Jimi Hendrix. John Hendrix, of course, the great jazz vocalist. And maybe there's a story behind that. You were traveling with your father.
Yes, I had come here. Michelle and Colleen Hendrix were very good friends of mine. Mm. We kind of clicked. You know, they lived here. They were going to school here. John lived here at the time. And all we ever did when we got together was sing. Because they were singers, I was a singer, and, you know, I was like 16 years old, and that's what you do. You get in taxis and you sing. You go out in the street and you sing. Yeah. So they were teaching me this song called That's Enough. Right. That was a gospel tune that John, I guess, had taught to them. So we did the three-part harmony on it, and we used to just sing it everywhere. So when Buddy was here recording, we came into the dressing room, right here, sat right here, and we said, listen, we're going to sing this song for you. And he was just sitting there, and he's like, we're going to record it tomorrow night. And John LaBarbera was sitting right there. He's like, John, write a chart. We're recording it tomorrow. So literally, John had to go out, write the chart, copy the chart, and get it all done to record the following night. Didn't rehearse it. Did it. That's the one on the record.
Amazing.
It's kind of unbelievable.
It is. That's right.
So, and I get to sing it while I'm here, which is crazy. You sing, it's so exciting.
Sing beautifully. You sing the Ding Dong, the Witch is Dead from the 66
Sammy
album.
Yes.
Sammy album.
So much fun.
Yeah, and a magical thing happened on Monday because Michelle Hendrix turned up here. She was doing a show at the King's Place.
Yes.
Miles ahead with Pete Church on
Yes, yes, yes.
So that was
incredible. Very odd because I had been trying to tell her that I was going to be here, and somehow we got, you know, sort of crossed in Facebook. Mm. And someone came out and they said, a friend of yours is here, Michelle. I said, Michelle Hendricks? Now, I haven't seen her in 30 years. So she walked in and we're just like, oh, my God. So if she had stage, I would have gotten her up to sing with you. Yeah. So very cool.
Lovely. Anyway, fantastic series of nights here at the club.
Yes.
Personal thank you for keeping the legacy of the music alive and bringing Gregg and the wonderful Dave Weckl as well.
Yes.
And these great musicians. They are fantastic.
Oh,
so we've got the cream of the crop with British musicians. You brought some alumni of Buddy Rich's band. So
absolutely. You got to have it. If you don't have the alumni aspect in there, you know, I mean, that's Buddy. These men played with him, you know, sat right next to him, just like, you know, tonight we're doing. So, you know, it's fantastic to have them here.
Great.
Yes. So thank you.
My pleasure. Thank you, Cathy.
Thank you,
Gregg.
Thank you.
And we're in the midst of a residency by the official Buddy Rich Big Band, featuring Cathy Rich, Gregg Potter, and of course the fantastic Dave Weckl, whom I have here with me, and we're going to share a few thoughts about the music and about Dave's career and his thoughts about Buddy Rich and so on. Hi, Dave.
How are you doing?
I'm very well.
Good to see you.
You too.
All right.
And I think we have something in common. We're both big Buddy Rich fans, and I'm certainly a fan of your music as well. Would you like to say how you first encountered the music of Buddy Rich? I know that you said on stage last night that you wouldn't be playing drums if it weren't for Buddy Rich.
Yeah, that's I'll take that. Okay. Yeah, it's pretty true. When I was, I had an affection for the instrument from a very early age, probably 7 or 8 years old. And, started playing to the rock records, and then Jack Sperling with Pete Fountain actually was my first introduction to swing and jazz with my dad's records that he had there. And I had been playing probably 4 years, maybe, when he brought home a Buddy Rich record, the first one, either, like I said, it's either Big Swing Face or a Swingin' New Big Band, whichever one that was at the time. And it was kind of a natural progression at that point, because Jack was playing complicated enough that it was a real stretch in education from the rock and roll, records and drummers. But then, of course, Buddy was, on a whole other level and just taking things, farther up, the ladder. And that was really the beginning of it, and I guess I was 12, 13 when that first Buddy record came along. And at the time, my drums were, I was an only kid, so there wasn't any sibling competition. My drums were set up in the living room in front of the big stereo system, and I would wear headphones and attempt to play along to these records, and learn the stuff, yeah.
And what was the first time you played drums? Were you playing any other instrument, or did you just take to drums? You were sort of hitting things in the kitchen and that kind of stuff. What was your introduction?
Yeah, it's close. I started trying to play guitar when I was 7-ish, somewhere around there, and I didn't take to it at all. I didn't like it, and I'm not sure why I gravitated towards the drums. I just remember, getting a pair of sticks from the kid next door that was a year older than me that had a rock band with his brothers, and we lived in a very, mild-mannered neighborhood sort of in the Midwest, it's near St. Louis, And these guys would just set up in their garage and play. There was a lot of music around in those days, and like I said, I think he gave me a pair of sticks, and I just started beating on box lids and grabbing my mother's pan lids and putting them on the bed. And of course, that didn't go over too well. So I think my father got me a cheap drum set at some point, and we put it in the workroom next to my little record player. And I just started playing to records, and guy next door showed me some things, and I found I could quite easily copy the rock drummers that were playing things, and it just kind of came naturally and quickly at first. Yeah. Mm. So that was the beginning.
Yeah.
To me, it's such an art, to kick a big band into to play the time to have the band work as a unit. And I still consider myself learning how to do this every day. Because everybody will watch Buddy Rich solos and they'll watch his left hand and they'll watch his technique and it's like, wow, wow. But it's like, for me, what is really fascinating is the way that he supports the band and the way that he plays with the band with his touch, with the sound, with the just the way that he did it. And that is such an art, you know, and it was him, and that, and nobody can do that, you know. So when I try to play with this band, I'm just trying to make the music work as I would want to hear it work in the style as only I can play it. I can't, I'm not attempting to play Buddy Rich Fills, or there may be a few things because, mind you, I did grow up learning them. Ooh. So when I'm in the shoes, you know, of playing the charts, it's like, sometimes nothing else is going to fit other than you know, than the little five-stroke roughs between the hits, or the way the left hand just continued to propel the music with almost a continuous shuffle and a continuous comp, you know, in between the ride cymbal. So, you know, for me, it's like I don't want to copy Buddy, and at the same time, I don't want to not play what's right for the music. So it's a fine line to walk, actually, you know, and I have to just go into it, you know, okay, this is me, this is how I'm going to play it, how I hear it, and that's where it's at, you know. But of course, there's always going to be giving the nods to what I grew up playing to, and what I think should be there, you know, in regards to the man himself. So.
There are many drummers coming to these concerts, as one would imagine, and I just wondered if you had any advice to give to up-and-coming drummers, those who have been around for a while as well, but anything you might like to add?
Well, I mean, I always say that, you know, the most important thing is foundation, is just learn the foundation, learn the history. And, you know, for me, foundation is, I simply break it down into four categories where it comes to the drums. And so technical foundation, reading foundation, independence foundation, and most especially listening foundation, to get your ears on as much music, as many drummers, and especially the history. I think it's so important to go back and understand and learn where everybody came from. If they're listening to, you know, to Steve Gadd or to even a lot of the newer guys, the younger guys that are coming out now, it's like everybody has a history. Everybody has come from this lineage of the great players, of which Buddy Rich is one of the most important. Sure. So, you know, but there's a lot of great, you know, and it all started with jazz. So we got to go back and listen to the Joe Joneses and the Philly Joe Joneses and, you know, all the great players, you know, of the past. So, yeah, listen, you know, just listen. Yeah. And then, of course, it's the application. You got to practice. You have to sit there and just do it, and try to hook up with a good teacher that can guide you. You know, teachers aren't there to teach you how to play. They're there to give you a path, to help you figure out what to do. Because in the end, it's always going to be up to the individual to practice to make, you know, something out of the knowledge that they're gaining. So you got to spend the time. There's no shortcuts. There's no easy ways. It's just, you know, you gotta love it so much that you don't want to really do anything else. And that's to get to that level. In my opinion.
I would certainly agree with you. And I think that it comes from love of the music. If you don't love the music enough, there's no point. And to go and listen to everything.
That would be one more thing that I would like to say, is to serve the music, to not be in it to, you know, to be a, you know, a show by yourself, you know, you know, it's, I always say there's just not a lot of gigs out there for drum soloists. So you got to learn how to play with people. You got to learn how to support the music and be as diverse as you possibly can. That's really it.
Well, that's extremely good advice. And thank you, Dave. This has been a wonderful number of minutes talking to you, and I hope you enjoy the rest of your time at Ronnie Scott's. It's been fantastic for us.
Well,
thank you.
I think I will definitely enjoy it, because it's been wonderful so far. So
good.
Can't wait.
Yeah, we all will. Thank you.
I'm just going to make sure the mic works. It does. It works. Fantastic. Oh, because I did my best speech then. That was something I'd rehearsed for days to get right, get those words in place, make something that wasn't too dreary, but had some relevance to the show we have tonight. We have a fantastic show, and I'm sure you have enjoyed it very much so far. How about it? Yeah! And, you know, I know most of the musicians here, they are incredible. I'd like you just to, you know, give them your appreciation, because they are doing a fantastic job tonight. Yeah. And we're in for a big treat now. We have a legendary drummer to celebrate, a legendary drummer. He's not a stranger to the club. He first came here with Chick Corea with his electric band in the late 80s, and he's been here many times with his own band, but he's here to honor the great Buddy Rich. I'd like you to welcome to the stage, after we've thanked the band, of course, welcome to the stage the fabulous but also very incredible Dave Weckl.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Wow, what an honor to be here. I'm so happy and, you know, extremely, as I said, honored that Cathy and Gregg have asked me to join them here on this very special night to honor Kathy's dad. Buddy was, you know, one of the most incredible players that ever sat behind a set of drums. For me, was pretty much the reason I play drums at all today. My father brought home a record when I was 12, I think, and I think it was either Big Swing Face or Swing a New Big Band, don't remember which one, but from that moment on, it was pretty much an obsession to try to figure out what the heck Buddy was doing behind the kit. And I've had such a good time as a kid learning and playing to, trying to play to all those records. And, you know, it was, you know, when you're playing to a record, it's, you know, it's, you can speed up, slow down, mess up. The record keeps going, right? Well, playing with this band is kind of like that. Because if I stopped, they are so happening that the time is, like, so ridiculous that they would just keep going and swinging their butts off without any drummer playing. So can we hear it for this band, please? All right. Killing. I also want to thank Ronnie Scotts for, you know, inviting us to be here. This is has always been a special place for me to come, mostly because I know that, you know, Buddy had performed here a lot, and I've watched the 69 performances enough times to, you know, feel like I was here then. But so this time is more magnified. I want to really thank Toby Cruz for promoting, and he's the one that really kind of got us here. So thank you, Toby, for getting that happening. We started with You Gotta Try, one of my favorites that Buddy had played. And we're going to continue with one that I kind of missed as a kid somehow along the way. I never heard it until later on, but it's slowly become one of my favorites. This is called The Rotten Kid. And most of all, thank you all for coming. And we're streaming tonight, so I know, I think my daughter's watching and a lot of friends out there. So thank you so much for joining us on this very special evening. Thank you. Thank you.
Dave Weckl. And the Buddy Rich Band. Gentlemen. Wow. Spectacular. Whee! I'm going to introduce all of them to you. But first, before I do, you know we're streaming live tonight, so make a lot of noise and let everyone hear you. Yeah, we're all over the world tonight. Woo! Actually, I want to take a minute and give a shout out to my son and all my family are watching in Nebraska. They live in Nebraska. So shout out to Nick and Brooke, Lex, Zion, Elijah, Gloria, all of you. We're here, we're thinking about you. Nick's going to come over the next time we come and sit in. So it'll be very cool. Yeah. Let me introduce the band. Down there on the end, formerly of the Buddy Rich Band, with Buddy, my good friend Mr. J. Craig. Rob Fowler. Yay! My other good buddy from the band, Mr. Bob Bowlby. Nigel, I can't look at you now without laughing. Mr. Nigel Hitchcock. Yay! Woo! Andy Wood on the trombone. Trevor Myers on the trombone. Mark Nightingale, yay! In that ridiculous trumpet section up there, all of those guys. Craig Wild. Andy Greenwood. Woo! And this gentleman, who I've known for a very long time, played with my dad, and is probably one of the greatest lead trumpet players ever, Mr. Eric Miyashiro. Yay! And standing next to him, also, former member of the Buddy Rich Band, the great Mr. Simon Gardner. Yes! And what can we say about this gentleman on the bass? Insane. Lawrence Cottle. Yes! Woo! Maddie! And over here, writing some of these ridiculous arrangements that you heard earlier just in time, and we're going to do one now that Matt wrote, and he's just incredible, Matt Harris. I love you. Love him. Love, love, love. David.
Cathy, it's that time of the night. It's very fitting that we close the show with Cathy singing another song. And it's an honor for me to play behind you. I love to play behind singers.
I love singing with you playing.
Great. Cool. So let's do this then.
Let's do it.
You're going to tell them what we're going to do. Right?
I am. Okay. One of my favorite albums that my dad recorded was something called Sounds of 66 with Sammy Davis Jr. And we're going to play one of those cool, fun charts right now. I'm not going to tell you what it is. We'll just do it. The witch is dead. Ding dong, the witch is dead. Witch, oh witch, the wicked witch. Ding dong, the wicked witch is dead. Wake up, you sleepy head. Rub your eyes, get out of bed. Wake up, the wicked witch is dead. She's gone where the goblins go below, 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 yo ho. Let's open up and sing and ring the bells out. Ding dong, merry o, sing it high, sing it low. Let them know that the wicked old witch is dead, 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 dead. We'll be right back.
the bells out, ding dong, the merry o, sing it high, sing it low. Let them know that the wicked old witch is dead. She's dead, dead, dead. The wicked old witch is dead. You know, it sounded like witch.
Thank you,
Dave Weckl and the band. Woo!
And the band.
Yes.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for being here. Thank you, thank you. And another big shout out to Toby Cruz for having us and bringing us here, and Ronnie's and all of you, and it's just been a dream come true. Thank you so much. Good night. One more? Okay. One more, Davey. Thank you.
Weckl. The band, Gregg Potter. Take a bow, all of you. Yes. Spectacular, gentlemen, all of you. You too. Woo! Thank you again for coming out, and we hope to be able to come back and play for you again soon. Thank you. Good night.
That's it. Cathy Rich, ladies and gentlemen. Cathy Rich, Dave Weckl, Gregg Potter, and the Ronnie Rich Big Band. Fantastic. And that's not the live end of the live music. We've got another quartet coming up in about 20 minutes. And that goes on to 3 a.m., but that's it. Let's hear it one more time for the Ronnie Rich Big Band.